Yeah, I got my lab coat on and do a little bit of tying. What I want to talk about today is last time I did a high float attractor pattern right here with a wing here and a wing here. The wing started a little bit past halfway. Well, today I want to discuss a little bit about the weight of the hook and the wings that we're using on patterns like this. One of the things you have to do, and the foam is part of this equation as well. This is a 3/0 size hook. If you put a half an inch strip of foam long and a quarter inch wide and strap it on this hook, it's still going to sink. The hook far outweighs what the foam can do to it. The same thing with any other material. So a fly like this, if you have a fly like this and the wing is only this big, the weight of the hook will offset this little bit of wing material. So you have to use the proper amount to have it floatability. Plus also the dubbing on a lot of patterns. You want to get the best dubbing, the lightest weight that you can use, but also when you dub it on, the water is going to get in there no matter what. Eventually it will take the fly down. On a hook such as this, or any hook, the massive amount of weight is right here. From the point from this bend here, that's where your weight is located. And what a lot of flies do, including this one here, a lot of the wing material is up toward the front, which means the weight is still here, and a fly will ride like this in the water if you want a dry fly. So to offset that, which we have to do, is you got to put some material in the back, and I'm not talking dubbing, to make that fly float. So I'm going to do one of these high float attractor flies, but I'm going to do it a little bit differently to offset the weight in the back. This is a 3X long number 6 streamer hook, so it means it has a heavier wire than a normal dry fly hook would be. And all the weight is right back here. That's where the massive amount concentration of the weight is. I'm going to put thread on here. It's just flat wax nylon. I'm going to layer this. What I want to do, you can call it a tail, you can call it whatever you want. I am going to put some wing material right back here, some high float fibers. And I'm going to use quite a bit. I'm going to cut it down here so I have a fairly long piece. I think I'll trim this just a little bit. I'm going to put it right here at the bend. I'm not measuring or using it as a tail. I'm going to use it as part of the wing. I'm going to tie this down, and I like this material because it's very lightweight and it will help float the fly better than most other materials outside of foam. But I'm not going to be worrying about foam. I'm going to do right here. I'm going to take my craft, just a dry fly dubbing right here, and I'll do yellow, I think, on this one. I'm going to dump a body on this, and a lot of times you tighten that body down to help, you know, floatability, but since it's a little bit coarse, you're tough to tie down, I'm not going to worry too much because I'm going to have my wing offset that. Every time I roll out, I'm pushing it with my finger. That's it. That gives it a little bit tighter. So I'm going to go right here. I'm going to take this wing, I'm going to pull it back and bump it. And I'm not going to rely on dubbing in front of the wing to hold it in its place. So a lot of times that collapses and doesn't work very well. I'm going to take this and I'm going to cut it off right here. Save this, use it in my dubbing. Tie this down. Then I'm going to take another piece. This is going to be a little bit, it's going to be just about as heavy. I want to make sure you get enough to help float the fly. That's a problem with many things. A tiny little wing like this is not going to do it. Put it out, make sure I have plenty to pull back. Right here behind the eye. Bump it up. And I'm going to tie this down. This is a lightweight material and it will help float the fly better. Which means I need less dubbing. Cut that off. Alright, I'm going to dub this. Like in the high float attractor, I'm going to put a little bit right here. In that spot, move up a little bit. I'm going to do the rest of it. This is yellow. trap dubbing. I put dry fly dubbing in there to help a little bit float better. Dub this on. I'm gonna go up, go back a little bit. Well, it's slightly loose, and the reason is because I'm going to brush some of this out. Right here, I'm going to make myself spot right there. Not right bite, a little bit up. I'm going to pull this over, tie it down. Take my wing, cut it. Everything matches here. You can make it shorter, you can make it longer. It matches right there. Tie this off. The bottom flat. I'm going to take this, take my Velcro, brush the thorax part of it. I want some legs coming out. There it is. But I want you to notice on this, I have three wings, one at the tail that'll help float the back end of this fly, one here that'll help float the back and the middle, and up above will help float toward the front a little bit more. This all becomes into one wing material. It's a wing, not a tail, but a combined wing. Fluff it up, add some fly float, and this will help float the back end of the fly perfectly straight in the water. Don't forget, use enough wing material to help float the fly. A little bit's not going to cut it, no matter what the material is, and that includes foam. They're high float attractor fly, an additional tail at the back end.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld an eerie sight, for my monster from his slab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on in a flash.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash. From my laboratory in the castle east, to the master bedroom where the vampires feast, the ghouls all came from their humble abodes to get a jolt from my electrode.
They did the mash.
They did the monster mash.
The monster mash.
It was a graveyard.